let Ms. Robinson introduce our keynote speaker this evening, Professor Griff. So we're going to turn this program back over to Ms. Living Like a Boss, Regina Boss. She's actually saved in my phone as Regina Boss. Boss. So y'all please give Ms. Boss y'all full attention.
All right, you guys. I am so excited about what's getting ready to happen. Normally when I introduce someone, I like to talk about, well, let him be there straight.
You need enough
man? All right. I talk about how I first met them, and I actually had the opportunity to be invited to speak at an event hosted by Professor Griff's son. And Professor Griff was going to be there speaking as well. And I remember I was walking down Martin Luther King in Atlanta, and he is standing on the side of the road, and he turns around and he says, "I'm so proud of you. You're such a pretty woman." And I was like so taken back. I was like, "Well, thank you." And he's like, "I'm gonna see you upstairs." And I went upstairs and I started speaking, and he came in the room while I was still at the microphone. And once I was finished and I went over to the little VIP area, he came behind me and he grabbed me by the shoulders and he said, "You're so powerful, I'm so proud of you." And from that moment to this, he's become someone that I highly respect. I love the way he has taken the time to get to know me and my son. When we talk about a community and a village raising our kids, he told me, he said, "Because we have now connected, I feel responsible for your son the way I feel responsible for mine." And that blessed me in such a major way. So I'm introducing to you someone that most of you know from entertainment, but someone that I know is a big giver and a lover of this community, and he is using his life to serve his people. I ask everyone in this room to stand to your feet right now.
Yes.
And welcome a new friend of mine, one of the members of, y'all know the group, Public Enemy. Yes, he's still in, right, Professor?
In the divine name of the Supreme Being, I want to greet everyone with a civilized greeting. Some say peace, some say hotep, some say shalom, some say assalamu alaikum. Some just say what's good, what's popping, what's happening. Some people say good afternoon. Whatever greeting you go by, I want to greet you. All right, how's everyone doing?
All right.
Let's give a round of applause for our good sister, Regina. Story she told you is absolutely true, and I had the two sisters that were speaking at night come up so that people could see women in action, all right, doing their thing. And as my big sister at the back table, Zaza, will tell you, I'm about creating this platform for women to be heard so we can balance some of this madness out. And I just want to let the men know that until we do that, this thing is always going to be off balance, because women represent the concept ma'at, which is truth, balance, justice, reciprocity, and most of all, order. And when you see the, when they talk about justice is blind, and you see the patron saint of manifest destiny blindfolded, holding the scales, which is justice, all right, if that's not balanced, all of this is going to be off cue, all right? And we have to understand this, so it's up to us men to create the platform. And then sometimes, and in most cases, just step back and move out the way and let the sisters do what they need to do. And if that can't happen, I'd like for any man to stand up and tell me, how else did you get here but through a woman? Nobody? Nah? You just, no? Well, that's good. I said, let's just do our divine duty and our divine right and reinstitute ma'at. Can we do that? So in keeping with tradition, I want everyone to kind of look around the room, find a very unfamiliar face. No, don't look at me, around the room, thank you. Find a very unfamiliar face. Everybody stand up out of their comfort zone and everyone greet someone. Stand up, greet, put your burger down, and greet, thank you.
about the great work in Atlanta.
How you doing? Good to see you. How are you?
Good.
Hey man, Steve, good to meet you. Hey sister, Steve. Good to meet you.
Good to see you.
Jacket it. I'm just letting you know that. I'm going back to the old school fight. Because sometimes I see my sons and daughters, they give these long text messages to their friends, but when it comes to dad, you know, I don't get it. I get a smiley face or a sad face because I didn't give them no money or whatever. But anyway, that's a beautiful thing. And whatever concept that we need to adopt and use, I'm sure Steve don't mind. You don't mind, right or wrong?
Absolutely not.
Let's just make it happen. So I want to kind of dive into this particular thing, and I hope I'm just not long-winded. I have someplace else to be in Florence in a minute, so Jahi's going to give me the cut-off time so we can kind of make this happen. But even though I have to be somewhere else, I got to deal with what's in front of me right now, and that's this particular situation and the people that are in front of me. Florence, South Carolina, just going to have to wait for a second, all right? This is a very critical and very timely kind of subject that we need to deal with. When I talked to one of my nieces early this morning, 5-6 this morning, I told her I was gonna come give this particular talk dealing with rights and goals, and I told her it's going to be a talk and the name of it is Boss. And she's like, Uncle Griff, so you know, is that some gangster shit? And I'm like, no, hey, that kind of boss you talking about. Her mind just went there automatically, so I had to sit that straight. So I gave her the acronym, and I told her about the business occupation service and significance, not only to the community, but to the self. So I wanna kind of dive into that. I'm gonna show some slides. I believe I cleaned the slides up enough to show in front of this particular audience, simply because a lot of times we have to be able to speak children's language. And if you don't speak their language, how many people remember the teacher on Charlie Brown, the Peanuts? You heard the that's how you sound to them when you don't speak their language. Are you following me? And we have to understand this particular dynamic, and when we have young people in the room, we have to be able to speak their language. All right? So let me just go over a few things that kind of came to mind. Kind of came to mind as I was listening to the entire program. When I say the entire program, I mean the brother that played the guitar stirred something in me. I began to write. You understand what I'm saying? I don't know whether or not if y'all know that music is a universal language, and it speaks volumes only if you can hear it. Are you following me? And in dealing with the whole idea of music being a universal language, all right, it speaks to that younger generation differently than it speaks to those of y'all that are in this room that are my age. Now, if you 50 and above, then you remember the Dells and the Dramatics and the Delphonics and the Moments and the Intruders. Sis, just sit tight. I know you haven't heard of these groups, so. The Temptations, the Marvelettes, are you following me? I mean, these songs hit us at the heart chakra. We remember where we was when Marvin Gaye dropped Sexual Healing, right or wrong? All right, when the groups came out and they talked about I Always Loved My Mama, we knew where we was. Those songs meant something to us, right or wrong?
Yes, sir.
When I had a conversation backstage with Prince, he talked about this music of today and he called it disposable music, bubblegum music, because it comes out, you listen to it for about 2 weeks, you dance to it, and then it's gone and we don't even remember it. All right, then we have to remind young people of some of the stuff that we used to listen to coming up. It didn't encourage us to fight, kill, and stab, and shoot one another. Are you bothering me? We never thought to take the pen to the pad and go into the studio and write negative lyrics about mom or auntie or grandma or about one another. Now, we did have some of those songs that were kind of edgy, but we balanced that out with what we had in the home, and that was a family. Are you following me? We balanced that out even if we had to press the historical cultural reset button. We balanced it out because we knew we would see one another at the family reunion. Are you following me? And this was very real. But the family is the thing that when we did come together at the family reunion or whenever we got together, all right, someone's birthday or when someone is born or when someone got married, and hopefully not at the funeral, but nonetheless, we always press the reset button. All right? So in listening to the brothers and the sister that was on the panel, I wrote that I said when I get up, I just kind of want to wait on the slides and I want to tell the people that I am my father's son and I am my son's father. I am my father's son and I am my son's father. Why do I say that? Because I have a dual responsibility, all right, of carrying on those particular things that my dad passed on to me. I'm responsible for those particular things and to make sure that my son gets that. What's that called in our tradition? It's called the oral tradition, all right? When asked, how do I learn some of these things that you know, Professor Griff? And I think I told the brother, yes, sometimes I watch the DVD, sometimes I watch the clips, sometimes I read it in the book, but most of all, you get it from life experience, all right? You get it from sitting at the feet of the elders and have them pass on those are particular things that you would need, all right, to reinforce certain aspects of your life. You get it from those stories that your grandfather told you. When you sat on your grandfather's lap and he told you those stories, and those stories was pregnant with hidden meaning, all you had to do was know the story and pass it on. That's what we did on the plantation. Am I right or wrong? We sang those songs because we knew there was a deeper meaning to those particular songs, even though we didn't adequately speak the English language. But we knew and understand we tapped into the God frequency. All right, now that concept may be foreign to some people, but can you imagine you on the plantation and this brother right here, this is your family right here, but your sister got sold down the river, your auntie got sold down the river, and you wanted to communicate with them, so you tapped into the God self. What did you do? We tapped into a sacred science and we waited for the winds to come by. And you spoke those words into the wind, you spoke those words and you sent out that vibration and you allowed the wind to take it downriver to your sister. Are you following me? And this is how we communicated with one another, and the slave master was baffled. He didn't know how we communicated with one another. Today, we call that the African grapevine. Are you following me? I don't know which brother said it, but when we did something in the community that was wrong, by the time we got home, we got 8 whippings. Are you following me? How did they know? They knew through the African grapevine. Are you following me? And it was one thing about my household. I'm the 7th son of 13 children, 12 child, but I'm the seventh son. Don't do the numerology right now. We'll talk about that a little bit later on. All right, but there's a duty and responsibility that I had being the youngest male. Now, I don't know how many other brothers in this room are the youngest male in their family, but there's a certain duty and responsibility that we have. That means that everything else that came in that divine line of the men in my family fell on my shoulders. Are you feeling what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
All right, so you held with that duty and that responsibility. Now, you may not think you was even equipped to take that information and pass it down to the nieces and the cousins and everyone else, but the Creator prepared you to do exactly what you're supposed to do. And everyone meeting in this room today, this is not an accident. This is not a coincidence. There's no such thing. We were meant to be here to hear this message from everyone that spoke. Are you following me? Even the people in this room that didn't speak, we fear you. Give yourselves a round of applause. I listened to the speakers and I wrote, I'm reflecting. I'm reminded, all right? And more so than that, I feel this sense of duty, responsibility, meaning to bind back to, sponsor the whole idea of having this ability to be responsible, to react, to engage, all right, the ability to respond. And then in that ability to respond, I have to show a degree of not only respect for our people, but self-respect, because it's coming through me. And we always say on our show, our ancestors speak to us from within us. We have to become our ancestors. I told one brother, I gotta stop talking Malcolm and be Malcolm, right? We gotta stop talking King. It's cool to invoke their name and their spirit, but we have to become that. Am I right or wrong? And we gotta talk the talk and walk the walk, especially with young people today, because they're tired of us talking right or wrong. They wanna see this in action, all right? And then there's just a few other things I wanna mention to you that I wrote down. I put down here the whole idea of the rights and the goals that I sent to Regina to put down in this particular thing that she had put together. And I wanted to talk about the rights simply because you have to come in and understanding your rights to go from boyhood to manhood. You just can't go into manhood and think you know it all. Am I right or wrong? So through my rites of passage, I went through the rites of passage in the streets. I went through my rites of passage in the military. And I went through my rites of passage in the Nation of Islam to become a man. All right? I had to see a man in order to know how to be a man. Are you following me? Now you're talking about dad passing away at six older brothers who was doing some of everything. All right? I still need to be able to be in that position to see what a man looks like in order to be a man. So I took those nonverbal cues. I took that nonverbal communication, all right? And I used those as mile markers. There was three things that I learned in the Nation of Islam that Elijah Muhammad said that our oppressor would not teach us. The science of business, the science of warfare, and the science of mating. All right? I'm proud to say that when I first had a child, I had that woman in mind that I wanted to marry because to some degree, I understood the whole idea of family, all right? Not to say that I was good at it because I got divorced a minute later, but I'm just saying, I had an idea of it. It just needed to be nurtured, that's all, and guided. But like most of the men in here, we got this testosterone thing going on and we think we know. So dad passing away at six, all right? I wanted to latch on to what the idea that I thought was a man. And those people became, you remember the 1968 Olympics? John Carlos and Tommy Smith threw their fists in the air? And you can see I do that today because that poster was on my wall. Malcolm was on the wall, all right? So Elijah Muhammad was on the wall. Che Guevara was on the wall. The Zulu was on the wall. Are you following me? And then these became the men that I kind of looked up to. All right, and this is very real because this helped shape my consciousness. All right, coming into man, just a few more things. I need everyone to be very, very real and very honest with me at this time. And by a show of hands, How many people remember the name of the building that we're in? Just raise your hand. What's the name of it? The Self Building. That's beautiful. Let's give her a black hand. I ain't never on nobody's plantation heard of the name Self. You? Where did they get this concept from? Because if you're planning on being a boss and dealing with some business, and you have an occupation, and you want to not serve the self, but serve our people with some kind of significance, right? We have to be able to tap into the God Self. Now, I don't really think that that's old boy's name. James C. Self? We're going to talk about that. You get it. All right. Okay, I get you. I'm here with you. Just a few more things, and I'm gonna dive into these slides, all right? The whole idea of to know us, as a matter of fact, let me read this quote and then I'm gonna dive into the slides and I'll just mesh this in with what I wanna show you. I don't have my glasses, so excuse me if I stumble over this. This quote is from the book The Sex Imperative and Wale Moke Bomani Baruti. In the 9th chapter, it talks about a tradition of purpose in order. Now please tell me that everybody in this room know their mission, has a mission statement for their life, right or wrong? Amen. Sure. Looking kind of doubtful, bro. No? Raise your hand if you have a purpose in life, please. Those that don't have their hand up, please get with someone that have their hand up so we can make sure you cultivate this purpose that we're supposed to have in our life. What's your mission statement? Let me tell you how mine sound, and I shared this with my big sister Zaza Ali. Let me tell you what my purpose is, and then maybe you can adopt one. And then every single day, when you're combing your beard, shaving, washing your face, combing your hair, looking in the mirror, all right, you can reaffirm this every single day, all right? I say on our radio show, we're souls in search of souls that are like mine, like mine. See how the church said amen? One more time. I'm a soul in search of souls that are like minds, like mine. So when I meet you and we're like-minded, there's a few things that we don't even have to discuss. I'm not concerned about you got the tie on and the suit looking groomed and all that other stuff. I'm not concerned about basic things. I'm trying to connect with those things that we're like-minded on. Are you following me? So we don't have to waste time. All right? So we have to understand it's all a soul in search of souls that are like-mind, like mine. Everyone has to have a purpose and a mission statement. That's mine, all right? We need to develop that and reaffirm that every single day. And with that said, in the book, The Sex Imperative, it says we must look at the psychopathology of everyday life and we must recognize that we cannot have it both ways. I'm not talking to the young people in the room right now. I'm talking about those of us that are responsible for young people, especially if you're a father, all right? It says we must look at the psychopathology of everyday life, and we must recognize we cannot have it both ways. We cannot talk about the people who have enslaved us, who discriminate against us, who insult us, who do all manner of other things against us, and then we turn around and use them as models of normality. And we have to understand this particular dynamic. And yet these people are held up as normal and are used as the standard against which we measure ourselves as a people. And we use them as models for us to determine the way that we raise our children. This is sick. You wake your child up in the morning, put them in the back of the car after feeding them Captain Crunch and damn Fruit Loops, poisoning their system, all right? You play these nasty, filthy songs on the radio on the way to the school, and then you get to the school of your open enemy, and you drop your child off in the hands of your open enemy, all right? To not educate them, but to indoctrinate them. And then you turn around after a hard day's work, don't pick them up and expect them to be normal. You need to stop that. And the reason why I say that, because you'll never find a rabbit dropping his little rabbits off to the squirrel school and expect them to be normal. Come on, talk to me. Am I right or wrong? And they come home with this damn squirrel mentality and this squirrel agenda, and you're looking at them talking about what's wrong. You're the problem. You're what's wrong with the children. All right? Now I know Gene is sitting back there like, man, I didn't invite this brother here. Don't worry about it, you're good. I'm gonna be all right. So we're here to talk about the community of self. We're talking about fathering community. And I felt that title when she sent me the flyer simply because coming up in hip hop, all right, ushering in a degree of consciousness, I felt that by ushering in this degree of consciousness, we have to be held responsible for it. And our thoughts, deeds, and actions must be in line with what we're saying. That was very difficult to do, soldiering with this guy named Flavor Flav. That was difficult as hell. Let me take my jacket while y'all ponder that. Just marinate on that for a minute. Community. We don't live in communities. We live in neighborhoods in somebody else's community. Because if we lived in community, we'd be able to control what goes on in the community. Are you following me?
Yes, sir. Wow.
Which we should look at the whole idea of community as the village. And if we don't have these neighbors, we have family members that live next door to us. Are you following me? And we have to understand this particular dynamic and concept. So before I move forward, because I see some people in the audience getting kind of angry, and call me at 678-557-2919 if you want a dialogue. I don't mind having that particular conversation. All right. I do like to say and give a round of applause to my big sister who's sitting in the back. That's Zaza Ali. Let's give her a round of applause. You do a radio show. You do a radio show every Tuesday and Thursday. It's called Enemy Minds on the Minds Matter Network. And also the brother that I travel with, Mr. Jahi Muhammad, in the back. Let's give him a round of applause. We don't necessarily choose one another. Our paths cross, and we recognize that we have to take this mission to another level. And all the creative is doing, whether you know it or know it not, is giving you a help meet to do what you need to do. Are you following me?
Sir.
Okay, so we must create that kind of space for one another. I told Mr. Mike G, I said, man, what you said is not necessarily a script that Steve and Mike and the sister here had to read from. Those are life experiences. Those are life experiences that when we listen to the panel, we have to draw from their life experience. Are you following me? And this is very real. Those are the most valuable lessons. Whether Mike, Steve, or the sister here put it in a book or make a recording or not, we was here to hear it live and in person. Am I right or wrong? Let's give them another round of applause. Like real quick. I put this Warriors tapestry together simply because I got two phone calls from two different brothers at two different times, 1:38 and 1:40. All right, and the brothers said that they had purchased the Acapella Revolution, they had purchased Analytics, and they had purchased the Psychological Covert War on Hip Hop, which are my other books. But they made a confession to me and basically said that I purchased the books, I support you, but you know, with tears, I can hear it over the phone. Tears rolling up in their eyes, they said, but I can't read. One brother told me that he went on YouTube to open the book to follow along on my lecture on YouTube to try to match it up with what I was saying in the book because he couldn't read. At that time, I went to the studio and I put together the Warriors Tapestry. It's an audio book. I'm saying all that to say this, not as a commercial, but I'm saying that to say we got to meet young people where they are.
Yes, sir.
Zaza said something to me. Last night, I think she was listening to Join the Crew, and it says, I'm not sure who it was, but she says, a lot of times we scream and try to teach from the mountaintop when we should be in the valley. Are you following me? And that's where we need to be, in and among the people. We need to be simply because why? The African proverb says what? I am because we are, therefore I am. Are you following me? Ain't no big I and little you. Never once, and these two people in the back can attest to this, never once do I take to the microphone and say, I'm Professor Griff, big I, rock and roll, Hall of Fame artist, and yada, 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 whoopie whoopie, and little you. I never do that. Are you following me? I am because we are, therefore I am. I can never be Professor Griff without you, and that's real. Everyone in this room, regardless of what you think of yourself, are you following me? Let's push forward real quick. I am someone's father. I'm someone's grandfather. And we have to understand this particular dynamic. Not part-time, not sometime, all the time. All right? And we must stay on our job all the time. I don't care whether or not it is teaching or karate or doing arts and crafts. Nonetheless, I have to stay on my job. We have to understand this particular dynamic, all right? I am my father's son, and I am my son's father. And this particular dynamic is very real, all right? And we have to take on those particular challenges, whether it come from the 15-year-old, or whether it come from the granddaughter or the 30-year-old, all right? I've met men in my life who showed me how to be a man and demonstrated that. And one of them men was the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Let's give him a round of applause. So when I met other men like Harry Belafonte, who when we walked across the stage to get the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame Award, which I never believed I'd be walking across the stage, because I really, that's not my thing, and Jahi will tell you. I was shocked as hell when they told me that I'm getting an award for a lifetime, me? Do the research. Anyway, when the brother made a very valuable speech and said some very valuable words that made that night all that, and then some, if I could use that terminology, all that more important than sitting in front of a room of 15,000 to 20,000 people, more so than receiving the award. Those words that he spoke, he was passing that information down to a younger generation. Are you following me? Tim, I went back to do the research and have this conversation about Harry Belafonte. The brother dropped on me the fact that he was the one that financed aspects of what Martin Luther King did. Did y'all know that?
That's right, yes sir.
Then we need to understand that unselfishly did it. Mm-hmm. All right, and didn't tell anybody.
Right.
You ever been a part, I wanna ask y'all a personal question. How many people in the room have ever been a part of something a lot larger than yourself? It does something to the soul, am I right or wrong? And that's very real. I ain't talking about sharing a damn peanut butter and jelly sandwich. I'm talking about something very real. All right? So in being responsible for my son, all right? I think Mike G said it. With the fathers, we're going to be tough. I think Steve said it. We're going to be tough. Steve said, I remember, I have the right to question my sons, to be hard and to be tough and to be nosy. Am I right or wrong? And we should do that. Let me ask y'all something. What will we tell the children 20 years from now when they see the madness that's going on today on our watch? What are we going to tell them? Where were you? Even the mothers in the room, where were you when this whole idea of women getting on in front of a camera on YouTube, twerking, taking off their clothes and doing some of the filthy madness that we see? Where were you and how come you didn't speak up? What are we going to tell the children? All right? We're held directly responsible for what's going on. I don't care if it's in South Carolina, Liberty City, Watts, or wherever we are. Chicago, on the South Side, it doesn't matter. All right? Let me move forward. We put out fighting power, and we borrowed a quote from Dr. Wayne Nobles. He says, power is the ability to define reality and convince other people that is their own definition. Dr. Wayne Nobles. All right? We need to begin to understand, if you do not define these terms for young people and clear away the smut and the madness, all right, off the lens that young people have to view life through, we're held directly responsible for that. Because I'm telling you, if you ever took your time and looked through the lens of young people and how they view this world, it's ugly. They feel we let them down and we don't support them. All right? And this is very, very real. So when we did fight the power, Chuck Decent, Elvis was a hero to most, and he never meant ish to me. Straight up racist, that sucker was simple and plain mother, him and John Wayne. They shook white people, they followed me. I mean, to the core. But nonetheless, we were held responsible for that. And then Chuck D says, if you can't change the people around you, then change the people around you. I'm gonna let y'all think about that for a second. Cause y'all are running with people right now that mean y'all no good. But because they've been your lifelong buddy, all right, you smoked a little weed, you drank together and hung out, and kicked it to women together. All right, you think that person mean you some good. And this is what Steve is probably experiencing with his sons. All right, and Mike is experiencing with his sons. We have to let them know, if you can't change these people around you, then you got to change the people around you. All right, and this is very real. So hopefully, I'll be able to pass something and you'll be able to walk away with something I said that's meaningful in your life and you can make it applicable to your children's life, especially your son. And then when we're alone and we get with ourselves, we'll know and understand that we are true fathers, all right? And we're the very embodiment of fatherhood. If no one else sees it, hopefully our children will see it. All right, let me move forward. I got some things to talk about. I was gonna talk about the Flavor Flav, the public enemy thing, but I'm pressed for time. If you walk away with anything, no one understand that on the inscription of every doorway in ancient Kemet, it read, you want right or wrong? So that's outside the concept of your damn belief, right or wrong? Let me push forward. To know self is to know God. Praise the Lord asked us to ask ourselves three questions. Who are we, where are we, and all that we ought to be in this world. Why? Because each generation, out of relative obscurity, passes program. This is why when the sister asked me to give her my points, I wrote them down as rights and goals. All right? You had to come into manhood, and men sharpen men. Men have to bring you into manhood. Are you following me? One of the fathers of black history, Carter G. Wilson, who gave us the miseducation of the Negro, it says, when you control a man's thinking, you do not have to worry about his action. He will find his proper place and will stay in it. You do not need to send him to the back door. He will go without being told. In fact, if there is no back door, he will protest until one is made for his use. His education demands it. His education demands it. With that said, we have to know and understand the whole idea, all right, of taking two sets of notes live with those fathers that are in the room right now. That's the instruction, not the indoctrination. That's the instruction we have to pass on to our sons. All right? My son got it this way. Listen, man, I'm not expecting you to be the brightest, the smartest, the sharpest light in the drawer. All right? When you go into that classroom, don't offer opposition. Learn the lesson, regurgitate that madness, and give it back to the teacher to get the grade so you can move on. But the other set of notes that you take is for your life experience. Two sets of notes, and that's very real. Because we do it anyway, right or wrong. And that's very real. So then when you're in school, you know how to operate and maneuver, all right, through racism, white supremacy. And then when you get in the street, you know how to maneuver through the madness that's going on. So our story needs to be told to us by us. Steve, it is your responsibility to make sure your children get it, and all those children and young people that are around you in your sphere. All right? Mike, take your belt and your shoestrings from you because you may hang your dumb self. All right? And then on cell block C, sagging pants is an indication for homosexuals to come after you in prison. And then they took that culture, hit the street, and married that on the hip-hop, and now became fly and hip and something to do in the street. So you ran your pants sagging, and sagging is actually niggas spelled backwards. This is very real. So there is a covert psychological war going on that's very real. Thanks, Sister Zaza, I really appreciate this. The psychological studies show that male and female children will follow and try to be like the adult in the home that appears to exercise the most power. Stop that in the home. Alright? She barking and you count them down. You in the kitchen with the apron on this, we'll talk about that. Because some of y'all looking at me like, don't go there. The child identifies both with the same gender pattern. Alright? What are our sons supposed to do? Alright? If they're identifying with the one that's the same gender and you're acting effeminate or effeminized. Alright? This is very real. So why our children hate us? You don't know them. You don't speak to them. You don't believe them. You don't trust them. You don't listen to them. You don't warn them. You don't protect them. You don't worship them. You don't claim them. You don't guide them. You don't love them. You push them. You deceive them. You doubt them. You use them. You betray them. You expose them. You blame them. You mock them. You ignore them. You fear them. In most cases, you even hate them. Yet they are our children. They belong to all of us, whether they're my flesh and blood or not. Are you following me? And we have to understand this particular dynamic. We were walking through the mall and we seen this t-shirt. What does it say, Zaza? Lazy but talented. Lazy but talented. That is not us. That is not us. They would not have came to Africa and got a lazy people to build their country. Am I right or wrong?
That's right.
They didn't go looking for lazy people. They went looking for people that could actually pull the damn job off, right or wrong, of ceremony, and you talk about popping molly. You talk about banging chicks and spinning rims and the acquisition of wealth. Are you following me? No, we don't need an applause, because I want to end this, because the whole idea of the CIA putting drugs in the black community. All right? As I often hear Zaza say, crack devastated Oakland, devastated her family. Are you following me? Molly has been a common drug lady and everyone is trying it. You pop one and you're sweating. Let me explain why you're sweating. It is a sweating. It is a drug that has cocaine, crack, ecstasy, and damn bath salt all in one. I've never done drugs, but if I try it and begin to try, I'm not putting all three of them together. What kind of damn high is that? Now, I know some of the people have gotten high in the room. Am I right or wrong? Oh, nobody got high in the damn room? Only me, right? Yeah, right, okay. So you hit me. That's how you wash your hands. All right, anyway. But this permeated the black community. This new drug. Yeah, you need to lean forward and look close because this is the new drug on the street. It's called crocodile. To the point where it rocks you from the inside out. And you can take your fingertips off, it rocks your flesh. This is a direct assault on our people. So for you to sit in your lofty place and not bring this information to our young people to know how to deal with this, even if you arm them with information, it's our duty and responsibility. Because Steve, would you want me to inform your son that this is going on? Yes, right? That's my duty and responsibility as a father to my own and to his when he's not around. The same.